hadn't played for over 25 years. When I was playing in my early 20s, quite a bit, I did not know a lot of the things that Kurt has taught me. So there's upper register aspects of this that I am absolutely a school child learning how to do it. So I am definitely what I would call a work in progress. I'm getting there, but I'm not there yet. But I have really enjoyed it. Kurt is a terrific teacher, and I really encourage you to pony up and make the commitment to get better.
Comeback players. These are people who've been off the horn typically for longer than 10 years, or you could be maybe 2 years. But the typical people that come in that are comeback players have been off the horn for 10 years. And if you look at some of my comeback player reviews, as much as 50 years. Can you imagine that? 50 years of not touching this guy.
Hi, I'm Dr. Gerald Dowling. I just recently finished the upper register course with Kurt Thompson. I haven't played my horn in 50 years. Enjoy making music. I would highly recommend Kurt. If you are younger, at any level, whether you be in school, whether you're at the university, whether or not you're professional, or you, like me, just enjoy music, give Kurt a try. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised.
Well, I also offer a free consultation over the phone or Skype. So that means no matter where you live in the world, you could kind of pick my brain about this course. So the consultation is about that, about the logistics, when we do it, how long the lessons are, how you send in your tuition, when to get started, when to get in the schedule, all those kinds of things. And what you can expect to get out of investing that kind of tuition in yourself for the next 4 months. If you're serious and you're about ready to take that step to really change your playing, it's a life-changing moment, really, after these 4 months, it really is. And just to have range and endurance and sound and just not be stressed out when you go to rehearsals, I mean, it just is just well worth it, folks. It really is. Just to have that off your head and just to be able to enjoy having fun with this instrument. I'm Kurt Thompson, and I'll see you, my friend, in the next one.
And if you're a trumpet player who'd like to get back in gear, you could do nothing better than taking Kurt's comeback player course. So I really recommend that you check it out and take lessons with Kurt. He's a terrific guy. He's a great teacher. He really cares about his students. And what more could you ask for in a teacher? So Dave Aronson signing off. And thanks again for everything, Kurt.
Kurt's program has given me the ability to do that. He's helped me improve my playing, but even more importantly, he's helped me improve my enjoyment in playing, because I'm not focusing so hard on whether or not I can play a note. Now I'm looking more at how do I play that note. So again, do I highly recommend Kurt's upper register program? You bet I do. Thank you, Kurt, for what you've done for my playing ability and my playing enjoyment. And folks, I want to thank you a lot for watching. Now be well.
I'm a comeback player, and I just completed Kurt Thompson's 16-week upper register and endurance course, and it was really great. But actually, I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about Kurt and his brand new course, the Ultra Comeback Player course. I think it would be perfect for any comeback player, regardless of their goal. In my case, I'd like to be playing back in a rock group, Latin group, or a jazz band, but a player who's just interested in playing for their own enjoyment, wants to make progress, or they want to join a community orchestra. I think it's the perfect structure to get you back into it in the right way and start feeling confident about yourself and enjoying the whole process. So I highly recommend you give Kurt a call, check out the course, and good luck to you getting back into playing again.
D. E. F. G. A. Two left. B. Yeah, we'll do one more. And C. Folks,
oh yeah,
the squeak of today is the big screaming note of tomorrow. You gotta get that in your noggin. I wasn't even planning on making this video, but it occurred to me, last week I had a student, pretty much high school age, I'm not gonna say too much because he's one of the subscribers here. He was frustrated, dejected, depressed, because we've been doing a lot of different things, and he said, well, I still can't knock out the double G, and the E and F are weak. We're talking about right above high C. And I said, well, let's hear what you got. And he could play the high C okay. No problem. He could play the D. No problem. But when he went to the E, it was real squirrely. The F wasn't coming out. Nothing really there. And then the G, double G was just really nothing. So I stopped him there and I said, okay, you're frustrated because you can't get a ball busting, Birdland, Maynard Ferguson, double G. Yeah, that's right. I'm frustrated. I said, well, okay, don't blow a lot of air through the horn. Let's just hear you just squeak. Hit that note out. Squeak. Don't hardly put any air through the horn. Just squeak. Out. He couldn't do it. He couldn't do it. If I'd had a loaded, dirty, hairy 44 Magnum, cocked it back and said, squeak that double G out or this gun is going to blow you to smithereens, we'd be having a funeral right now. He could not squeak it out. And that brought me back to my roots. And I don't know if you've heard this saying, but the squeak of today is the note of tomorrow.
The squeak of today is the note of tomorrow.
Okay, maybe you've heard that before. Now, what if you can't squeak? You must be a squeaker before you can be a screamer. So, are you hooked on trumpet screaming and screaming high notes? You love it? Yeah, I like it myself. Well, if you are and you want to be able to do that, but you can't squeak out the note that you want to get, doorbells and bells and whistles should be going off in your head saying, wait a minute, let me work on just getting a couple squeaks to happen first, and then we have a very tiny but small foundation to work on. So that is what this video was all about. It's kind of a trumpet lesson, isn't it? A tutorial. Go up like I did in octaves and see how high you can get, but don't worry about putting power beat. That's a different practice session. That's a different technique. That's Claude Gordon, whatever you're doing. This is not that. You're just going up as squeaky as you can. How high can you go in squeaks? You got to figure that out first before you get depressed and mad at yourself that you don't have ball busting, paint peeling, hair-splitting double Gs. I mean, find out where your squeaks are, and then we have something to build on. So I'll leave you with my triple C squeak that you heard at the beginning. Gotta squeak it before you can scream it. Boom, Kurt Thompson. Like this video, subscribe, and watch a lot more. I'll catch you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Hey, this is a trumpet lesson video on how to expand your range and flexibility with some good old-fashioned lip slurs. In this particular trumpet tutorial, these are often overlooked lip slurs, three lip slurs that are overlooked, and I would actually call these a stealth technique. Now, why am I coming up with this? Well, I have taught now in 2018 over, just barely, but over 1,500 private individual students. That's individual different students over the years. One common theme that I noticed, even amongst those who could play high C, high D, high E, and then others, of course, that had difficulty playing those notes, all these players had trouble with three lip slurs on the horn, from D to F, E flat to G flat, otherwise known as D sharp to F sharp, and E to G. We're not talking about the super duper high ones. We're talking about right near the top of the staff. You might want to use this to check yourself. If you have problems with those lip slurs that I just mentioned, you really need to watch the rest of this tutorial. In fact, I want you to play along with me. Use the metronome. The metronome is very critical because it will show you if you are increasing your speed or not. And of course, we do want to increase our speed cleanly. So now enjoy working along and expanding your range and flexibility.
All right, here we go. This is going to be the sheet starting on D to F. So the whole thing, all the exercises here will be in first valve. And I have the trusty metronome set to 120. The quarter note equals 120. Now, in your own practice, you can do the repeats as many times as you feel like. For right now, we're not going to adhere to the repeats just for time. One, two, one, two, three. One, two, three. And you can go back and repeat this on your own if you like. Now, those were quarter or half notes, then quarter notes. Now we're in the eighth notes. Second line. One, two, three. And again, you can go back and repeat that as many times as you wish. Now, those were all slurs. The first line, the second line. Now, you'll notice that there's no articulation delineation on the third line. They're all 16th notes with a big arc over all of it. And that is going to be our lips trill section. So it's not interrupted by any kind of articulation, and it's that ah ya ya you move it back and forth. A one, two, three. Or you could go back and
you don't really have to tongue on the second measure. So let me just do several of them in a row. 1, 2, 3. Okay, 16th notes. Now for you advanced and pro players, you could ratchet it up one more notch, right? To 32nd notes. And this is just a bonus. That should be pretty close to 32nd notes. But for everybody else, you'll just stick with the 16th notes that we have written on the page. Let's move on to the next sheet, which would be D sharp to F sharp. Again, these are the three most troublesome lip slurs on the horn. And if you can really work on these and get them down, I promise things are gonna be so much better all over the horn, but especially in the upper register. So now everything here will be second valve. If you happen to observe on the first sheet, everything was first valve, right? So now everything here will be second valve. Here's the first line. The metronome has still been banging away at 120. 1, 2, 3. And there you got a couple of measures of rest, and you can go back and repeat this as many times as you want. Moving on to the second line, eighth notes. 1, 2, 3. Okay, you got your two measures of rest. And the third line are good old-fashioned lip trills. And you could, I personally wouldn't break up the two measures here with a tongue, although that's the way it's written, isn't it? But personally, I'd just sail on through and probably go as many times as I could in one breath. Oh, by the way, you notice a two below the exercise and a bunch of dashes, and then a two and a bunch of dashes. That just simply means to play everything second valve. 1, 2, 3. Okay. And then for you advanced and pro players, 1, 2, 3. Should be pretty close to 30 seconds on those. Moving along to the last sheet. And this is the last one, and the highest of the three, starting on E. And I already told you the second sheet was all second valve. Well, this last sheet is going to be all open. And we still have the metronome banging away at 120. Quarter note equals 120. It's the same format, so let's go ahead and tackle this one. Starting on E to G now. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. And then you got your rest there. You go back and repeat. And second line. 1, 2, 3. Rest a couple measures, go back and repeat. And the last line. Our good friend, the lip trill. 1, 2, 3. And for you advanced and pro players, the bonus round, 32nd notes. 1, 2, 3. All right.
I hope you really enjoyed working along with me on these three different lip slurs. You're going to get something out of it. I guarantee for the investment of practice time on these three lip slurs, you will see an increase in your range and a big bump up in flexibility and facility all over the horn. Keep track of your metronome progress. Give this a couple of months. Make it part of your normal routine. Leave your fantastic positive comments as to what happened to your playing down below in the review. Give this video a like. If you found value in this video, you can go over to Patreon, and I'll include a little way to do that right now.
Please go over to Patreon, become a supporter, support my channel and my work and what I'm doing. I really need your help. Thank you so much. This is Kurt Thompson.
You just saw the first stage of compression for brass players. What does this funky balloon got to do with the first stage of compression? Actually, if you blow it up, now we're not, blowing up the balloon is not the exercise. Okay, the first stage of compression is about taking in more air via your diaphragm into your lungs and creating so much pressure on your lungs that the air almost wants to force its way up through your throat and out through your mouth. There's so much pressure there, it almost feels like the horn is kind of playing itself. And there's a lot of energy behind that. If you just look at this balloon, if I just let it go, boom. It just went way up. I mean, there was energy there in that balloon. So, I'm not an engineer and I haven't studied engines and machines and rockets and stuff like that, but I do know one thing. There is a difference between a jet engine and a propeller plane, or that type of engine. And we're talking about planes. The jet engine is based on that principle of the balloon, building up so much pressure, then poof, it releases all that energy. It's quite amazing. That's what we are doing as brass players in the first stage of compression. We are filling up our lungs with so much air to the point that they're not going to burst, but that air is going to explode up through our throat, out through our mouth, and into the horn. And of course we're able to regulate it along the way. So if you don't have the first stage of compression, that extreme amount of air pressure trapped inside your body, you could have the tongue arch going decently, and you could have the last stage of compression, which is your aperture. You could have that down pretty good. You're still going to be misfiring. You're not going to be firing on all cylinders like a Lamborghini would be, or a Ferrari. So there are exercises that I have my students do to really work the first stage of compression. And the one reason I have them do that is because it's the least complicated technique. And most students, whether they're eighth graders all the way up to comeback player, old timer people that haven't played in a while, I mean, most players, regardless of level, can get and master the first stage of compression, compressing the air velocity in our body. So, and yes, we can increase the space in our lungs. Did you know that? What happens if your lungs normally stretch out this much, but through some techniques I'm going to show you, they stretch out that much? Well, now you have this complete pressure cooker inside your body, but this bottled up air just waiting for the air to explode. I mean, it's quite amazing. You have to have that. And is this important in only playing high notes? No. I found having great compression from stage one, from the initial stage of compression at the diaphragm level, is really, really helpful for getting a great tone and having that effortless quality of playing in the low and middle register and the kind of lower upper register, which I would call high G, high A, high B flats, right around there. So this is really, really important to your brass playing abilities, your tone, your output, and your endurance. If you don't have compression at the first stage of compression through diaphragmatic breathing, you're going to be using these. You're going to be taxing out and juicing out your chops, and you're just not going to have a lot of endurance. You're going to be pushing the mouthpiece harder to get the results that you want. You will be able to get it temporarily, but eventually you're going to be blown out and fatigued out. So if you're at all interested in the first stage of compression, there's three stages. If you're interested in the first stage, because that is the least complicated, it's the one that everybody can do and you can learn it, you can master it quickly, then you might want to consider some of the courses that I do, or you might want to consider working with me privately. And that doesn't matter if you're in Zimbabwe, Russia, China, South Korea, Europe, or Tallahassee, Florida, it doesn't matter. We do it via Skype or over the phone. So I have these ears. These ears are really, really good. And it's pretty amazing. I can hear someone play over the phone and almost instantly I know what they're doing wrong. Okay? I don't even have to see you. But if I can't figure it out by hearing it, I will watch you. And I'll figure it out after that. So I hope this was helpful for you. In case I didn't emphasize this, there are three stages of compressing the air, and they all have to be just perfectly aligned and just mastered to get the absolute astounding sound, tone, power, accuracy, endurance, and of course the high range. You take one of them out and you got problems. Doesn't mean you can't play, it just means that you have problems and challenges. So I just introduced to you with the balloon dynamic that is the first stage of compression. And I thought my camera was like, sorry about that. My stand has about 8 books on it. I got my phone here on my stand. That's what we're doing right now. And it's about ready to go kaput with all the books on there. So I better take the arms off next time. So anyway, hit me up with an email. Kurt@trumpetsizzle.com. You can easily find my site. You can email me from here at YouTube or Facebook or just about anywhere, and we can talk about and go into detail about the different techniques that you actually need to be working on for the first stage of compression. You might as well be doing it because it's the easiest one to work on and the one that will give you the quickest results. The others actually give you the most potent and best results, but unfortunately they take a lot longer to master and to really get the feel of. I'm talking about tongue arch compression at the bottleneck, and I'm talking about aperture compression. So those we need to work on too, but those are not overnight successes. Usually it takes a while to get those down. So I'm going to take this off my stand before it all screws up and falls on the floor. You can see how dirty my carpet is. Ooh, there we go. So anyway, hope you find that interesting. The balloon is not an exaggeration of what we're doing at the first initial stage of compression. It really isn't. It's not. It's exactly what's going on inside our lungs. The diaphragm pulls down and it creates a lower pressure in our body. That lower pressure lets the air rush in. And the more air that can rush in, the more pressure that can be created. That's the first stage of compression. It's science, folks. Not art. Science. I'll see you in the next installment where we're going to be talking about the second stage of compression. That moment when you go, ah, I shouldn't have taken all those days off the horn. Now we've all had that moment. Really, we all have had that. And then as you practice and kind of get back in the groove, the great stamina and the range and the endurance and your tone and accuracy and sound
just seems to be a little bit out of reach as you practice every day to get back to where you were. At some point, it dawns on you that you are back, but how long was it that it took you to get to that point? And that's the ambiguous, elusive part of when you take off from this instrument. It's very unforgiving. Unforgiving, let me give an example. I've been so busy over the last week that I wasn't able to get to the gym, you know, my 3 or 4 days a week. So it's been 5, 6 days. I went to my same machines and weight workout routine thinking that I was going to be weak, not doing that well, not have a lot of energy. And because we're talking about large muscle groups, I actually felt stronger. I had a hell of a workout. That's a week off. So what's the difference in taking a week off from running, walking, working out, Zumba, yoga, hiking, whatever it is that you do? And then you get back in the groove almost right away. But on this instrument, uh-uh. What is the difference? I am not a doctor or a scientist, although I play one on TV. But I suspect that it's because of the extremely small, fragile, and fine muscle fibers that are right here in our face that are a lot different than the big muscle groups of our legs and our back and our shoulders and our chest and our arms. So it's very, very weird about our embouchure and the fact that within 24 hours of not playing it seems like the tone and the muscles tend to atrophy right away. You know that, right? Don't believe me? If you've been playing 3 or 4 hours a day and gigging several times a week, and you all of a sudden go to nothing for 3 days, try it. Your chops will just be like wet spaghetti. I mean, it'll just be like blah. I mean, my suspect is due to the fact that we have very, very small feather-like muscles around here, and not the huge, dense muscles of our shoulders, buttocks, legs, back, chest, and then the most dense muscles are our abdomen and our calves. Those are the ones supposedly you could work out every day, and they're still going to get stronger. So this tutorial here is giving you a little bit of some inside information that can only come from a guy who's been looking at this stuff for decades. I know, not 1 year, not 5 years. You know, I've been playing longer than 5 years. I've been teaching. I've been looking at this stuff for maybe longer than some of you have been even on the planet. So I've come down to a ratio that you saw in the title, 3 to 1. 3 to 1, up to a certain point. What I figured out with my students and myself, it takes about 3 times whatever you took off to get back, up to about a month. After that, it changes. So maybe that didn't seem clear. Let's just give you an example. You're used to playing every day. You're used to practicing 2 to 3 hours a day, which is good for an advanced or professional player. Maybe you're in a rehearsal band once a week, and you gig once or twice a week, or maybe once every other week. It doesn't matter, but you're used to playing a lot. You take off one complete day on your horn, and it just may take you 3 days to get back to where you were. A lot of times I do recommend that for myself and students, just to let this heal and let the muscles really get stronger and recuperate. Yes, you do have to do a graduated practice regimen for a couple days to get back to where you were, but you're going to be stronger the way I have my students do it and the way I do it for myself. But so 1 day may not be the best example, but that is the ratio. 1 day off on the horn and you got to take 3 days to get back to where you were. But now let's do a little bit more extreme. Let's do, you have a weekend jaunt with your girlfriend or your wife. Or if I'm talking to a female brass player, with your boyfriend or husband or partner. So you're going to be gone off the horn now for 3 days. What you're going to find is, now this is where where the data really comes in. If you're used to playing a lot and your body's used to having a lot of practice, a lot of face time with the metal here, you will find that by taking three days off, in general, you're going to have to spend a good week to a week and a half, about 9 days, just to bring you back to where you were. So most of you don't know that. And so you get a little frustrated as you come back in a couple of days and you're going like, crap, I only took off 3 days, but I'm not even playing as good as I was last week. Oh, that's why. So you need to have that in mind. You need to go ahead and prepare for that. If you're this summer is winding down in about another month, but maybe you have a week-long vacation with your family. And I know that's the case with some of my students. They're telling me, I don't know how I'm going to be able to practice every day, whatnot. So I give them the suggestions on how to do it, but the fact is, a lot of times you get distracted and you don't practice. So I'm here to tell you, you take off 1 week for the family vacation and don't touch this at all. I mean, nothing, zero. You're going to spend about 2.5 to 3 weeks just to get back to where you were. That's the sad fact, but you need to know that fact so you can prepare and just know, and that'll reduce your anxiety and frustration levels. Now, for all of us that fall into that parameter of a 3-to-1 ratio, you're always going to be able to cite the one exception. I remember reading, was it Roger Ingram's book, where he talks about that he traveled from, now it could be somebody other than Roger Ingram, I'm thinking Roger Ingram, but he moved from the East Coast, I believe, to the West Coast, and he wasn't able to practice. He said he did some mouthpiece buzzing or something like that. But he tells a tale about how he was off the horn for a week and started playing, and he just like, you know, like he never fell off the horse. He no problem, no nothing. He would be the exception if I'm quoting him correctly. Most of us would not be able to go a week without playing. And then all of a sudden, you know, you're gigging, you're playing, you're teaching, you're doing all these things, you're practicing 3-4 hours a day. Most of us can't do that. He would be the exception. It's kind of funny. Here's a little bit of trivia that I found from one of Maynard Ferguson's interview. He tells a story about how people used to be amazed and in awe and wonderment. Wow, Maynard, you just show up to the gig and all of a sudden, I want two, bar. And then boom, he starts playing. Like, you know, he's just killing it. And they're like, this guy is amazing. Maynard can show up on the gig and doesn't even have to warm up. Well, Maynard in one of his interviews says that he does warm up. He never just shows up to the bandstand with it, pulls his horn out of the case cold and plays. And he said his secret is he's usually warming up in the car. At least during this juncture, when he was playing, he was warming up on his drive to the gig or to the rehearsal, and he was all warmed up by the time he got there. So he didn't have to play but just a note or two, and then he went for it. So even Maynard, you know, had to make sure that he was, you know, warmed up and playing for a gig. And I suspect that if he took off a couple of weeks, he probably would feel it, and he would have to, you know, definitely take some time to get back to the horn. So this is a very important tutorial, mainly for strategy and mainly to reduce your stress, anxiety, and frustration. I mean, if you know in advance that if you go on that vacation or if you're without the horn for 3 or 4 days, you just have to know it's going to take you triple the amount of time to get back to where you were before you stop the horn. That's very, very important data, folks. This tutorial, although it's free, I mean, it's priceless. It's gold in your pocket now that you know that. So let's carry it to extreme. You take off 2 weeks on the horn, expect to take, you know, a month and a half to get back to where you were. You take off 3 weeks, it may very well take you 2 months to get back to right where you were. It doesn't mean that you can't play. And it doesn't mean that you can't go to some of your gigs or rehearsals. It's just you will not be firing on all cylinders like you were before you took off. I mean, 3 weeks without touching this? Hello? Man, your face is going to go to jello. I'm just here to tell you. If you don't believe it, I mean, it is. It's just going to go to jello. Now, what happens when you get to a month? Now, once we get to a month, the ratio changes.
So the ratio of that 3-to-1 magic elixir does kind of stop around a month. So after a month, the ratio changes. It goes down. It might go to 2-to-1. You take off, let's just say you take off 6 weeks. It's not going to take you 18 weeks, you know, to get back in the groove. Maybe it might take you 2 months or something like that. So this ratio is useful up until about 3 to 4 weeks of not being on the horn. And this is for all brass instruments. So you can use this ratio, because most of us aren't going to take off a month. If you do that, that means something's probably gone pretty bad in your family or for your personal life. Maybe you were in an auto accident. Maybe you came down with some kind of disease or something. So something tragic or bad happened if you're taking off more than a month on the horn. For most of us, it tends to be 3 days up to about a week. It's very, very common. And so you can expect if you took off a week on this horn, you need 3 weeks to get back to where you were. So again, this is an important, this is absolutely gold in your pocket now that you know this. And I've known it for quite some time and have been telling my students about it. And I thought, well, why keep it a secret? I looked around online to find out if anybody had any message or tutorial or data or information about this. And it seems like nobody talks about this or even knows about it. Or I'm sure people have thought about it because you're frustrated when you're off the horn and you come back and just like your mouth is like jello and you just can't play. So there you have it. Now you know. Now you can prepare. You know, if you're going to take off 3 days on the horn, you need a week and a half or 9 days to get back. Most commonly, if you have to take off a week, 7 days, give yourself 3 weeks to really get back to where you were. It's going to take that amount of time. And the other thing is, and this is probably a topic for a different tutorial, there is a way to get back. If you've been playing 3 hours a day and you take off for a week, you just don't come right back in on 3 hours a day. You're really going to shoot yourself in the foot. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed and really appreciated the gold that's in your pocket now from this video. You know now that when you take off the horn more than a day, times that by three, and that's the amount of time it's going to take you to get back to where you were before you took off on the horn. Now you know. I'm Kurt Thompson. I really hope that you enjoyed another great video from my channel, Your Brass Instructor. Of course, you know you could always go to trumpetsizzle.com and get involved in a plethora of programs that will really make the cream rise to the top in your own self and playing and your music education. And again, like I say, in some of the videos, you never have to take my word for it. There are just too many people reviewing and talking about my courses, given an objective point of view on what happened to them after they studied with me and or went through one of my courses. It's right here on my channel, but it's also elsewhere online. So hope you enjoyed this tip and tidbit of information for all brass players, and I'll catch you in the next one. Hey, fellow lead trumpeters, screamers out there, high note hitters. Do you notice anything a little bit unusual about my trumpet? Now, you know, it's marching band season, and this video is going to be published somewhere at the beginning of the fall of 2017. And I know a lot of you guys and gals in high school and college are hoofing it, and you're having to push the power out on notes as low as right above the staff, all the way up to blowing out some massive high C's, D's, E's. When it comes to getting that quintessential F above high C and double G's at the end of your marching band song that you would love just to kill everybody on and shatter the glass in the press box, you can't do it. I have an instant high note range trumpet hack that will instantly propel you up that last half or whole step with power. And this is temporary. You shouldn't use this all the time because you... Hello, don't you need to build some freaking chops? I mean, build yourself some freaking chops, baby. Come on now. But this will get you where you want to go. You didn't catch it yet, huh? Right there. Pull this out. Oh, what's that? What are you looking at me for? Go to my other channel and watch the rest of the tutorial. Hello? Hello? Hello?
Don't just keep looking at me. Go watch the rest of this tutorial on my other channel, Fast Results Trumpet Courses. Hey, you're still... Come on, go, go now, go, go, go. Beat it, bye-bye, go, go.
Welcome to the Herbert L. Clark Etude 2 Trumpet Challenge. And this is being presented by Kurt Thompson of TrumpetSizzle.com and Your Brass Instructor on YouTube.com. You know, it's funny, I just recently did a challenge on YouTube just for fun and purposely indicated I didn't want to be in the running. And then I've also put up several challenges before in the past, and they all have a common theme, and that's being able to play in the upper register. Unless I've missed it, I haven't seen any challenge on tone, finger dexterity, technique. And so I thought to myself, how many trumpet players from intermediate to advanced to professional are not able to do most of these challenges you see on YouTube simply because they don't have a good double G in their back pocket. And when I answered my own question, the answer was a lot. Only a fraction of trumpet players are able to play Fs, double Gs, double As, and double Cs, and most of them can't do it well. They're not really the type of players you want to hear doing it. That leaves an ultimate fraction of the entire trumpet universe that can play and sound well in the upper register. Everybody else cannot, so why not make a very interesting trumpet challenge that doesn't force somebody out of the game right away because of high range? Isn't that a good question? I think it is. Anybody who's been on my channel knows that I'm all about the physical part of trumpet. I mean, I'm more about other things too, but I'm all about first getting the physical, because if you shun the physical and just work on music, you're not going to sound very musical because your tone will suck. Your endurance will be faltering. Obviously, you won't have any range. You won't have any fingers. The physical has to be there. And the Herbert L. Clark book is just one staple in a trumpeter's practice diet. That's a must. So here you go, folks. You don't need to have a double G for this trumpet challenge. In fact, all this trumpet challenge this week, and we're talking about the last week in February of 2018, it spurred my imagination as I've watched countless people struggle with the most recent trumpet challenge, which involves some very, very high notes. And I thought to myself, what if these guys could apply, and gals, what if these individuals could apply themselves to a trumpet challenge that is extremely challenging and difficult, but you don't have to rely on double G's and double C's to win the challenge. And I've come up with the perfect challenge. It's the Etude 2 at the very end of the second study in the Herbert L. Clark Technical Studies book. So the metronome marking is important, and the style and phrasing is important. It's not difficult, and of course the right notes are important. The sum of it all together does make it quite difficult because you have some real finger twisters in the Etude 2. When you turn the metronome on at 144 equals a quarter note, it really, really becomes quite a snarl to be able to accomplish all this, sound smooth with a good tone, and play even. I think I personally would like to have trumpet players focus just for once on something that's not range related, Let's see how fast your fingers are, how even you play your tone down below the staff. And I'm raising my hand right now. My tone is not the best on low G's below the staff. I'm guilty. But others that I've heard sound beautifully, just gorgeous, low C's all the way down to low G's. That's not an area that I focus on, but I realize it's still part of the trumpet game. I mean, we still got to be able to sound good in all areas. And so my hand's raised as guilty. I know I don't sound the best on low G's below the staff, but I bet some of you trying this challenge will sound great, and I want to hear that. Let's make it even more interesting. How about this? The grand prize for whoever plays the best in all aspects, tempo is definitely high up there, and accuracy is too. We're going to go and give them the Herbert L. Clark course, the 90 days to razor sharp technique that I have. It's going to be on the house free. It's going to be the prize for whoever wins this. You know, even if you don't win it, I mean, it's not much money. You know, you can go to my website. It's, you know, under $100, you know, for this 90 day course. So it's really not much money anyway. And most of you should be involved in that course anyway, because it helps expedite your progress in the Herbert L. Clark book. But let's set that aside as far as everybody else, and we'll talk about the winner. The winner will receive the 90-day course from me regarding the Herbert L. Clark technical studies. So there you go. Now everybody who's working on this has some skin in the game, and you have something to win. How cool is that? And you're not required to pay anything to get involved with this challenge. You do need to submit a video that shows yourself. This can't be anonymous. You have to have a real first and last name, no usernames. And you have to show your face. You have to show yourself. And you have to mention my name and that we're doing this trumpet challenge. That's it. Free, except for your time and sweat equity into this project. I'm excited to see all the people who didn't have double G's in the last so many trumpet challenges come out of the woodwork, get involved, and have some fun. Now, just to make sure you know that I'm practicing what I preach, I'm going to include my rendition of the Herbert L. Clark Technical Studies Etude 2 at the Clark tempo of 144 equals a quarter note. And you're going to see that right now. You should already own the Herbert L. Clark Technical Studies, which is the book that contains this Etude 2 for you to practice for the challenge. If you don't, you could screenshot the Etude 2 that you see in this promo that I'm doing. If you'd like, you can just screenshot it and print it out. But I highly recommend that you send the money and go buy the Herbert L. Clark Technical Studies. Every trumpet player should have that. It's a travesty if you don't. Just go get the entire book. I'm Kurt Thompson, trumpetsizzle.com, youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. And I think that we can have a lot of fun with Herbert L. Clark. And most of it is in the staff or below. Can't wait to hear and watch you play it.
Jean-Baptiste Arban. If the Arban's complete conservatory method for trumpet, if it's the Holy Grail, well, why aren't we all doing it? The thing is, we all are doing it. So the Arban's is one of the Holy Grails to this guy. Hey, we got one. Tell you what, my money is on any trumpet player that can play the 14 characteristic etude studies at the back of the Arban's book up to tempo. My money is on that trumpet player, male or female, I don't care who it is. You know you're playing if you can play those 14 characteristic etude studies at the back of the Arban's book. If you can play Fantasy Brillante, and if you can play Carnival of Venice, and a whole host of others, I mean, wow. Some of their, some of Arban's interval studies, the Arban's book is the holy grail to trumpet playing. Now, it's not going to make you play like Maynard, but I'm guessing Maynard probably could have gone through that Arban's book at age 10, 11, 12. At age 12 or 13, took the whole damn thing up an octave, and by age 14, he was going to downtown Montreal playing lead trumpet, playing double Cs. That's the natural talent that he had. So, in my opinion, and the Arban's is a process, wow. The Arban's complete conservatory method is about that thick. It really leaves no stone unturned. The only thing that it doesn't really go into is the super playing that we have to do today, the extreme, the upper register and the extreme upper register, lead playing and stuff like that, playing in the Maynard Ferguson style, right? But wow, the Arban's is, that method is the holy grail to this guy. So we are all doing it. It's hard to find anybody that is worth their salt, that is even the bottom rung of professional level caliber player that hasn't worked in the Arban's a little bit. Most of us have worked the whole damn book, seriously, and then some. That's my take. If you haven't been working out of the Jean-Baptiste Arban's complete conservatory method for trumpet, you are missing what some people call the Bible for trumpet. I mean, you're missing out. There's going to be some deficits in your playing if you haven't gone through that book and given a serious practice and approach. That's my story. Kurt Thompson, sticking to it, baby.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson, and welcome to my channel. That's youtube.com/yourbrassinstructor. Thanks for just watching the video that you did. Maybe it's the first one that you've watched, or maybe you've watched tons of my videos. In fact, as of June 2016, as a brass player and trumpet player, I have the most tutorials free on the planet. I have over 600 videos on my YouTube channel currently, all free. So again, thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Are you playing on two or more mouthpieces on a regular basis?
Bad idea. Throw one out. Learn to play on one for everything.
This guy right here.
Do you think he was a jack-off and fumbling around with a bunch of mouthpieces all his life? This dude over here, same thing. The best of the best choose one mouthpiece to fit the bill. Maybe 1 or 2% of the time that you have to play something that's so whack out of your normal playing style, maybe for that special occasion. Give you an example. I almost always play above the staff wherever I play. I mean, that's what I got to be good at. But if someone called me in to play Come to Jesus in whole notes at the New York Philharmonic sitting third trumpet, I might have to get me a Bach 1.5C. I might even get me an old Bach Strad 37 bell and just hunker down and go through all those whole notes. I mean, come on. Because maybe the equipment I have might not be the best. But in general, you want to find the mouthpiece and the setup that's right for you. Now, here's why you don't want to be the fool that plays on two different mouthpieces. Number one, at the very least, even if you're as good as this guy, and even if you're as good as this guy, guess what's going to happen to you? Even Maynard or Maurice, their accuracy is going to suffer, at the very least. And that's if you have the talent of Maynard or Maurice. As I look to you right now, I'm just betting you don't have the talent of Maynard and Maurice. Sorry, them's the facts. So if that could happen to them, it's going to happen to you. Your accuracy is going to go out the window. Number two, air in your tone. Your lips gravitate towards a certain position and a certain expectation. The minute you throw them for the loop, bam, with the different mouthpieces, you start to develop inefficiencies in your chops, the vibrating surface of the lips, and you begin to notice, yes, air in your tone, all over the place. High, medium, low. Now, because I don't spend my career playing below low C, hear a little air there, a little bit, that's just the name of the game for me because I position myself for playing much higher, usually above the staff. However, the people that switch up mouthpieces tend to have that air in the tone all over the horn. Accuracy out the window, air in your tone. The other thing is chop problems. People that tend to have two or more mouthpieces that they play on regularly every week tend to have chop problems. And I don't know all the facts of this guy. I think you heard about him. His name is Mr. Bergeron. I mean, I don't know all the facts about that guy. I don't know too much about him at all. But I did hear in the wind that there were some chop problems that he had a long time ago. And if I had to bet a dollar bill on what was going on as he was jumbling up the mouthpieces, my friends, he was playing on more than one mouthpiece, maybe a host, maybe he had a flugel mouthpiece for this and a pick mouthpiece for that. And maybe he had a mouthpiece for a big horn to get a larger, warmer, darker sound for some classical session work. And then maybe he had a normal setup. I bet you if I had to roll a dice and bet a dollar, it would be because he was playing on too many mouthpieces. You start playing on too many mouthpieces on a regular basis, and you're going to have chop problems at some point. If it doesn't come for you this week or next month, it's going to come for you 3 or 4 years from now. Come on. So the word is, what are you going to not do from now on? You're not going to play on two or more mouthpieces regularly. If you have to, you know, get a shallow mouthpiece because you need to play a pick part and you normally don't play in that register, then by all means, go ahead and do it. If you're normally a lead player and you get called to play third trumpet or second trumpet in the Messiah, you might put your horn equipment, your lead trumpet equipment away, and you might get out your, you know, dust off your old Bach Strad, pop in a Bach 1.25 or 1.5 and go to town on those low notes. So otherwise, you want to stick to one mouthpiece. The quest should be to find the absolute best mouthpiece that you can play almost everything on, and that's what you stick with if you don't want to have the problems I mentioned.
Ba-ba-ba-da, ba-da, ba-da.
What are the three problems that you're going to have if you play on two or more mouthpieces every week? You're going to have accuracy problems. You're going to miss notes. You're going to get air in your tone, guaranteed, but in all registers. And three, chop, serious embouchure and chop problems are coming for you, my friend, if you decide to dance with the devil, and the devil is a two or more mouthpiece dance. I'm Kurt Thompson. Like this video, like it a lot, and go ahead and subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you in the next fun video. Bye-bye.
Please go over to Patreon, become a supporter, support my channel and my work and what I'm doing. I really need your help. Thank you so much. This is Kurt Thompson.
This is a test of endurance for the classical trumpet player. I'm positioning myself in front of a clock, so that will keep me honest. You can focus on the clock the whole time. That ensures that there's no break in this video, and it's honest. The test of a professional caliber principal trumpet of any symphony orchestra in the world is to be able to play through the third variation of the Fantasy Brillante three times in a row. Let's give it a shot. One down. Catch my breath. The clock is still keeping me honest. The tape is still rolling. Okay. That was one down. Now, let's just cut to the chase. I am not striving for perfection here or for a style or anything like that. I'm just simply trying to go through this three times, almost back to back. So that was one time. Here we go. Still watching the clock. tongue's on fire. Whew. Okay. Remember, this is a test of your classical trumpet playing endurance. This is only a test. This is not for style. This is not for a recording session. This is not for perfection. This is not for even pointed and clarity of attack with articulation. This is a test, a physical test. And I'm not allowing myself to rest too much in between these. Last time, three times, is the ultimate test for any professional principal trumpet player of any celebrity well-known symphony. And that goes for Mr. LA, that goes for Mr. Chicago, that goes for Mr. New York, that goes for Mr. Boston, okay? It's the ultimate test for a classical trumpet player, likely an advanced, extremely advanced, or professional. All right, I just bought myself a little time. Third time, folks. Now, what will happen is if you can't pass this test, your tongue will bog down like a cold engine out of oil on a 20-degree night. It'll just bog down. You won't be able to go. That's just the nature of this particular test. Third time. You see the clock? Everything's still rolling, baby. There you go. See if we can make it through the third and final time. And as a reminder, this is page 312 in the Arbenz book if you got the big, complete conservatory method. There we go. Cross all my fingers on this one. Touch and go at the very end. As you could tell, I really felt like I was bogging down. And when you bog down, folks, on something like this, you can't make your tongue move. That's just it. You might still have some chops to play a little bit longer, but all this gone. So this has been Kurt Thompson. I brought to you the ultimate classical trumpet player's test of endurance. And it came from the Fantasy Brillante in the Arbenz book, the back of the Arbenz book, and in my book, if you have the real thick book, kind of looks like this, about the size of a Bible or an encyclopedia, it actually is on page 312, at least in my book, and this is what it is. Tough. I'll probably take a little snapshot and put it up at the beginning and the end. And for everybody else who is not primarily a classical trumpet player, and you mainly do jazz, or you mainly do commercial, or Broadway, or lead trumpet, I'm here to tell you, don't even fool around with this. Don't even attempt this. You're going to hurt yourself. I'm not joking. I'm laughing, but I'm laughing if someone were to try this. If you're primarily a lead trumpet player, or you're a commercial player, or you're a session player, you mainly go in and read little ditties and little jingles, or you're in Seattle and you're playing lead trumpet for the Broadway shows there at the Paramount or the Fifth Avenue, the Pantages down in L.A. And that's primarily what you do. Don't even think about doing this. You're gonna hurt yourself. You're gonna hurt yourself bad, real bad. At the very least, it'll screw up your tongue so bad that you can't do your tongue arch and your range will go kaput. And you will be a very ineffective lead trumpet player. This is for serious classical trumpet players who make their living playing and teaching primarily classical trumpet. Test yourself. The clock has kept me honest. I have not made any cuts. I have not edited this out. Even the couple little stutters that I've done, I've not edited that out. Nothing's been edited out because the clock has kept me honest. I went through it 3 times and see if you can do that. Test yourself. And if you can't do it, hit me up with some comments and or questions, probably questions, and I'll give you some pointers on how to best accomplish that. Otherwise, if you found this of value, if you liked it even a little bit, go ahead and go down there and click the like button. Give me a thumbs up. And if you're a classical guy or gal and you're not a subscriber, why not subscribe? Just to let you know, behind this video, there's over 1,000 videos similar to this. And you might just get something out of it. At the very least, you're going to be entertained on some of the stuff that I do. You might even laugh at some of the stuff that I do. But mostly, you'll probably find quite a lot of value in the stuff that I do. I'm Kurt Thompson. Please like, please subscribe, and I'll definitely catch you in the next one. So long for now. All right, jazz cats. I'm getting a little bit long in working on the jazz, developing your ear so you can start to spit out some of the stuff you're thinking of. And this is going to be a great jazz trumpet lesson for you cats out there that want to try some ear training. We're going to take the first part of the melody to I Dream of Jeannie, and we're going to run it through the cycle of force through all 12 major keys. And I'm going to tell you right up front, well, you should already know, you know, I am not the quintessential jazz musician yet, but it's getting there. So in other words, I'm out of my comfort zone. I'm out of my expertise. So it's not likely that I'm going to fly through all 12 keys perfectly. This is about using your ears and hearing and feeling the notes on your where how they lay out your fingers. And it's you know, this is, or you should already know after watching some of my jazz stuff, I'm just getting into this, but I am getting better. I would think I Dream of Jeannie is more complicated because it has wider skips in it, and anytime you go a lot wider when you're trying to construct a jazz solo, and especially in various keys, I mean, things get more difficult. So we're not going to take it too fast. I'm going to go a little bit slower than probably the original tempo. And you guys can go along with me if you want. So what I'm doing is just starting on the original. I believe this might be the original starting note for the main melody in I Dream of Jeannie. But if it's not, it's okay. It's the key of RG, a concert FG. And so after I start the first one, I'm just going to go up in force, or you know, up or down, depending, but it's still in the cycle of force. So the first one is starting on E. Okay. Now, if we go up a fourth from that, the starting note will actually be A. So we're actually in A. Here we go. Starting on A. If we go up a fourth from the starting note of A, we now go to D. Ready? You can hear me still kind of bobbling around. But I'm a lot more improved than I was, say, a year ago before I started getting into this. Okay, so we started on, what, D? We got to go up a fourth, and so we'll be starting on G. And we don't have to make this a high note thing, so can we actually start down on the middle G? We probably could. Yeah, we don't need to pop out high notes when we're trying to get our jazz trumpet on. Okay, so what was that? Was that on G? Okay, now let's go up a fourth. So we're going to be starting on C. Middle C. Really using my ear for this stuff, folks. I mean, really. You know, I'm not looking at any music. And I don't know if you can tell. I'm just closing my eyes part of this time when I'm doing it. So we started on C. Let's go up a fourth. That'll have it started on F, the starting note. Okay, it's going to get a little more tricky. Can we actually start on the low F, or are we going to run out of room? We can do it. Yeah, okay, we'll start on the low F. Let's climb into the more interesting keys. Okay, so what are we going to start on? B-flat? Starting on B-flat, folks. And we do need to go up into the staff. We're not going to start down on the low B-flat. That's not going to work for us unless we go to the pedal tone range. Here we are. We're starting on B-flat. We're still doing I Dream a Genie, just the first part of it. And we're obviously down from the original tempo. Here we go. You're gonna flub up a little bit, but heck, that's part of the jazz trumpet, baby. Let's go to, unless you're Arturo or John Faddis or somebody like that. Or actually, really, the quintessential person that's not gonna flub up is gonna be Chet Baker. That guy doesn't miss. Seems like once he knows just one note of a tune. I mean, if he was doing this, I mean, he probably would have already finished right now. Chet Baker just would have flown right through all of it. So he's the dude. So, and right now I'm not. But I'm trying. Okay, so where are we at now? We're going into, we're starting on E-flat, right? Here we go, baby. E-flat. Can we actually start down low? Yeah, we can start up a little higher. Here we go. Whew. I'm trying to hear it. My fingers are kind of falling along. Okay. Here we go. Let's start on A flat G sharp. Here we go. Whew, I'm having to use my ear, folks. I mean, big time. Okay, so what was that? A flat G sharp, so we go up a fourth, and we're on D flat C sharp. Okay, so it's almost like we're kind of coming out of the woods a little bit. Okay, we'll start on F sharp. Low, middle,
Hi. There we go. Okay, I Dream a Genie. We're starting on F sharp. There we go. I think we can start on this middle F sharp. All right, moving on to up a fourth would be B. And we'll start on middle B. Did we make it all the way around? That was B, which means if we go up a fourth, we're right back to where we started, right? If you did that with me, or if you do it on your own, I feel like you just went through something that was a little bit beyond just the beginning jazz trumpet. No, this is probably not what Arturo does or what John Faddis does. It definitely is not what Chet Baker was doing. I mean, we're still baby steps. But when it comes to the world of jazz, I believe this particular jazz exercise and routine is not a pure beginning jazz deal. I believe that this would be have to fall at least around the intermediate level. I don't think that you can take too many beginning jazz students and have them do that. What we just did through the I Dream of Genie TV theme show, if you get out your horn and do what I just did, no music, in fact I'm not even listening to any background music, and go through the 12 keys, you're gonna go, ooh, wait a minute. Even if you're a pro jazz musician, you might have had to think a little bit about this. But for us jazz musicians that are right around the intermediate level, and I would say that I'm probably not quite intermediate. I'm there. I'm just almost there. I'm like kind of past the beginning. Just maybe not quite intermediate jazz, but it's getting there. And remember, I'm giving myself 10 years, so I still got, 9.5 years left to get up there with... Arturo and Faddis and Morrison and those guys. Will I ever get to be up there with Chet Baker? I don't know, man. I don't see it, but there is a progression to it, and that progression starts to speed up. And so who knows, but I mean, well, let's just put it this way. I mean, some of the jazz greats of today I don't think are as good as Chet Baker, so it might be very dubious at best for me to even get close to Chet Baker. Guys, he has a memory and an ear that just, I don't know, can it be beat? I really don't think so. I mean, you can't beat that guy, Chet Baker. But this was a great jazz trumpet lesson. In fact, I might list it as an intermediate jazz trumpet lesson. The reason I would do that, because someone who's just starting out with jazz or on trumpet might find what we just did here in this particular tutorial to be very, very tough. I mean, you heard me. I'm not pulling any punches here, and I'm not using any trick photography. You heard me bobble a couple of notes. I mean, this is live. I did this live. No trick photography, no dubbing, cutting, nothing like that. And so you heard me bobble a couple of things. You know, I'm just going totally on ear. So anyway, I'm Kurt Thompson. I hope you enjoyed this cool ear training jazz trumpet lesson, and go back and do it a few more times. This is not an easy test of your ears and the way your fingers lay across the horn, so go back and do this a couple times. I think that you're going to get something out of it. I'll see you guys in the next one. Keep it jazzy, baby.
Hi, I'm Kurt Thompson at TrumpetSizzle.com and here on YouTube, you're a brass instructor. I'm a professional trumpet player and teacher, and I want to ask you a question. Would you like to learn how to skyrocket your range, improve your endurance, and reduce mouthpiece pressure? At the very least, you should discover that improving range and endurance is a process, It is not one book you're going to read, not one ebook. It's not one lesson you're going to take with a celebrity trumpet player. It is a process that you will have to go through. If you're willing to go through this process, I can almost guarantee that you will get fantastic results on this instrument or any brass instrument. And for right now, I would just like for you to subscribe to my channel. Look down below and click the subscribe link. I would love to have you as a subscriber on my channel, Your Brass Instructor. I'm Kurt Thompson. I'll see you in the next one.
Watch carefully. What do you see there? Slow it down. This is the trumpet hack for this tutorial. Are you catching it? The trumpet hack for faster and more even fingers is keeping your finger pads almost glued to the button caps right here. That is the trumpet hack. If you can get that down, you'll notice that you can play faster and that you have more even fingers, more even playing. To enhance that, of course, practicing with the metronome would be complimentary to that, you know, to make sure that your fingers are even. Most of us need a strict approach so we can get better at faster fingers. And as you saw me at the beginning of this tutorial, well, let's just talk. Can I play my F major scale as fast as Maurice Andre? No. Alan Vizzuti? No. Arturo Sandoval? No. Wynton Marsalis? No. Those guys can play faster on that F major scale than I can. I hate to admit it, but that's just the way it is. That they just have very fast, great finger speed. But for what I do and for myself, for my package, my total skill set, I'd say I'd be coming close to them and with my technique. And let's just face it, I'm not going out and doing clinics and master classes playing the Arbenz upside down, or what would I see him do one time with one finger? Something like that. That's not me. That's not my skill set, going out and doing stuff like that. So, but yeah, those guys got faster fingers. But if you watch that F sharp major, try it yourself at that speed. I believe that's probably faster than most classical players could do it live and unrehearsed like that. So I'm pretty proud of that. It got that way by this trumpet hack that I did a long time ago. And I got it just to show you guys. You're gonna have to get some double-sided tape. Doesn't have to be 3M. It could be anything that you find at Walmart or Home Depot or Lowe's or Kmart. Doesn't really matter. Target. It's got to be double-sided, and you'll need a pair of scissors. And what you're going to do is just try to train yourself. And you don't want to leave this tape on, because I don't know what the residue, you know, the glue would do to your button caps. Mine are worn, so I'm not really caring too much about what the tops look like. No one ever sees that anyway. So I'm going to get this tape going here, and so there we go, that came out pretty easy. So it's going to be sticky on both sides, so I'm going to cut off just about, and some tape is good and some tape is not good. Let's hope this tape actually sticks to the button caps. So I'll be putting the first one on here, like so. Doesn't have to be perfect. So just kind of push it on there. I'm not going to take the other side off just yet. Let's get the next one going. Yes, this is a trumpet hack, folks, and it is weird and quirky. And you might not even like doing it for the first week or two because it's going to slow you down. It will slow you down in the beginning because you're going to have to start playing correctly. See, I'm getting the other one up there now. Doesn't have to be perfect. We just want it sticking there good. Yeah, let me cut one more. So you're going to have to go through this kind of learning curve, this period of shedding, where you slow things down, slow your scales down, and really focus on keeping your fingers in a good position and as close to the valves as you can get. Okay, so now we got the tape on all three, and maybe just kind of smash them down there a little bit. Now, I don't know how good this tape is. I hope it's good enough that it's not going to come flying off when I start playing, but I want to lightly peel this off if I can. That one came off pretty easy. And I don't want to waste your time here while I'm screwing around with this tape to see if it will just come off. Come on, baby. It's being stubborn. Hey! Now, can we get this guy? It looks like it's just about ready to come off. I don't have any fingernails. Come on, guy. I wonder if we can just squeeze it off like that. Okay, it looks like this one's gonna fly. Okay, there you go. What you have now is, this is a double-sided sticky tape. That will be sticky. Now, it's not gonna be strong enough to glue your fingers to the valves, but what I want you to, what's the best way to say it? What I want you to be conscious of is your fingers are glued to the valves just temporarily, and so I want that to come up on your radar. That's why we're doing it. You need to be thinking, oh yeah, my fingers are connected to the valves, so don't yank them off. Try to keep them close. And so now I'm going to press on them. I can already feel it sticking. Look at that. Okay, my fingers are actually on there. Yeah, it's like my fingers are actually stuck there temporarily. See? Now you can go through your scales. You just knocked out four scales right there. C major and C minor. Let's see, what else do we want to do? Well, then some of the harder scales, maybe. Look at my fingers, they're glued to the valves. Wow. Fingers are stuck. No, I can lift them off. That is the number one trumpet hack for developing faster and more even fingers in record time. I'm convinced if you do this diligently for as little as 2 to 3 weeks, you'll notice a significant increase in finger speed and a much more even style of playing. And this doesn't matter if you just play classical or if you just do jazz. Or if you're kind of a high note guy like me and loves to play the most difficult music on this horn, which is the written high note trumpet solo. So, I mean, that's what I like doing, but I like the challenge. That's the most difficult thing that you can do on this horn. And so it doesn't matter if whatever it is that you like to do, this will help out your technique. Again, this is Kurt Thompson, TrumpetSizzle.com. If you thought this was kind of an unusual but interesting tutorial with some value to it that you might actually try, go ahead and subscribe down below. Click on the like button. Make a comment. And what I'm trying to get people now to do is to get more involved, more interactive with my stuff. So if you can actually do this and practice and film yourself when you first start, and then let us know after 2 or 3 weeks of implementing this trumpet hack how it really helped out your finger speed and made things more even for you. And if you do a pretty good job, mention my name and your name and maybe a couple other things, I'll be willing to put you up on my channel and your name will be up in lights. So watch. Still, you can see my finger being, yeah, it's gonna come off. And these will come off. Look at that. So you don't even have to worry. So you don't leave it on there long enough. See that? See? If you left this on overnight, I don't know if you'd have a problem with residue on your valves. See? And these are, actually, I think it cleaned off my valves. My valves are shinier and a little bit cleaner. So there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. A great, awesome, number one trumpet hack for increasing finger speed, dexterity, and coordination and evenness of playing. It really doesn't get any faster or better than this, besides what you already know. To work on your scales, work it slow and perfect with the metronome. You already know that, but that's a longer road that you still have to take. This is not a shortcut or a substitute for that. You still need to do that, but this is a trumpet hack that will get your fingers faster and more even in just a couple of weeks. So anyway, subscribe, like, hit me up, and then hit me up with a video showing how this really worked for you. See you in the next one.
Subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
No, I'm not doing all that. But there are exceptions of amazingly technical players whose fingers are all over the place. So you got, basically I call this popsicle sticks, where your fingers, that's Maurice Andre, your fingers really, you gotta watch him. His fingers are just all over. Then you got the claw. That's usually a lazy hand position. I call it the claw, it looks like the claw. You're kind of like this. Your hand's barely, it's a lazy position. Your hand's barely coming across. And then I'm trying to think of what other one what might be. Well, this one's a bad one. This is another lazy ass way to play. Looks like that. Now, if you have to hold your hand in one arm because you're on a gig and you got to turn the page, which I've had to do many times, yeah, you don't have to be that extreme. I mean, I might be like that. But I've seen a lot of people that just constantly play like that. I don't know how they could ever get any speed playing like that. Pinky in here is going to slow down and make your third finger uneven. That's guaranteed. Don't believe me? Wiggle your hand. Just nice and free. See? Slow it down. Okay? That is just as though you're playing and their pinky. See my pinky floating around? Nothing's screwed around my third finger. Now check this out. Take your hand, grab your pinky as if it was in the little crook, just bring it back just gently, and now try to wiggle your fingers. I'm trying my hardest. I can't get the third finger to move. The third finger is so closely attached to the pinky that you're going to screw yourself up when you have a lot of fast stuff to do, and you're not going to be even. So that's probably one of the worst ones right there is this. Thumb up here. And what are you going to do for a vibrato? I mean, I don't know. This is just a real shitty hand position.
Subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
That new mouthpiece. This one cost me a pretty penny. Wonder whose initials those are. Let me take it out of the box and I'll be right back. New mouthpiece fake out. What's that all about? This is my new one. Don't really intend to use it until if and when the other one breaks down. But I got a duplicate of my custom. And, okay, so what's this video about? The new mouthpiece fake out. It happens just about every time you fall in love with a new mouthpiece. It could happen, not it could, it does happen to the most famous, most accomplished players on the planet. You don't have to be just a trumpet player. This could be a tuba player, trombone player, French horn, baritone, you name it. You guys all know what the bell curve is, you know, like when it comes to scoring and tests. Looks like a bell, like a, you know, like a Liberty Bell. Well, when it comes to the new mouthpiece fake out, we, all of us brass players, will fall on an inverted bell curve. In other words, it's not going up, but what happens is you get your good spot here, then it goes down, kind of like a trough, and then it comes back up to where you were. It's like the inverted, like the opposite of a bell curve. So what happens is you try several mouthpieces out, and you like it, and you're going, oh my God, you know, I got an extra minor third on my range. This plays great. I can play louder. I can play softer. It responds great. I'm in tune. It slots well. Ooh, or it's darker or brighter. Whatever you love, it's that. You get it. And lo and behold, within usually 3 to 5 days, that mouthpiece ain't feeling all that great. In fact, you're right here and you're just, you don't realize it, but it's at its best right here. And you're starting to go downhill. That inverted bell curve happens every time to everybody, even if they don't admit it. That's how it works. It's called the new mouthpiece fake out. So what happens if you keep going down this trough, where it has a way to go, it has a progression. So you just have to know that. Most people don't know that. Once you get down to the bottom of this inverted bell curve, you're down way in the dungeon. People, this is usually about a week and a half to 2 weeks into your new mouthpiece. People start going, dang, I don't know what happened, man. I screwed up here again. I thought I had the perfect mouthpiece for me. Lightning strikes again. I screwed it up. Dang it. And so at that point, you begin thinking things like returning it, exchanging it, or selling it on eBay used or whatever. And you look for your trusty old mouthpiece that you've been using for all your life, or at least for many years, and put it back in. You play a little bit, and you're like, well, it's not as good, but it's old, tried, and true. And so another mouthpiece bites the dust, another new one. And you put, that's why people have shoeboxes full of mouthpieces and drawers full of mouthpieces. What you didn't know is that as you're at the bottom, now here's this inverted bell curve. As you're at the bottom, if you just would have stuck with it another week, to maybe 2 weeks, you would have come out of that because your chops, everything is getting used to the new angle, the new width, the new backbore, the throat, the cup, the sharp, what kind of taper it has, all that kind of stuff. How far is, you know, the receiver is going into the lead pipe, all that kind of stuff. So this is all adapting, and when you're near at the bottom, it's not feeling good. And you're thinking you made a mistake. You didn't. While this is adapting, it's finally growing accustomed to your new mouthpiece. You're actually coming out of that trough. You're coming back out of the inverted bell curve. So, my friends, if you had only waited just another week, maybe 2 weeks, in extreme cases, it could be 3 weeks, but usually it's 1 to 2 weeks when you're kind of at the bottom. When you come out of that, you'll be going, okay, this thing is on the money again. I mean, I'm loving it. So what you just experienced is the new mouthpiece fake out. And the new mouthpiece fake out is so good that it causes people to take their new mouthpiece after usually between 1 and 2 weeks and say, screw it. It's toss it in their shoebox or drawer or try to resell it. And that's the fake out. The reason it's a fake out is because that mouthpiece is still an awesome mouthpiece for them. They just don't know it. They just don't know if they hung on another week or two. And plus, practice the right things. That also helps. things would have been back to where they loved it. Now, this affects everybody except for maybe the most minority of players. Bob Reeves told me about Bud Brisbois one time, that Bud Brisbois was wanting a new mouthpiece, and I guess Bob was making him one. And Bob called him and said it was ready. He said, "Great, man, because I'm on my way to a recording session." That's something I wouldn't do. So Bud Brisbois could do that. I mean, Mr. Chops of Steel. So I guess he took the new mouthpiece, tooted a few notes, got back in his car, and went on his way to a recording session. And that's something he could do. And maybe for someone like Bud Brisbois or Bill Chase or these type of phenomenal, maybe even Maynard, I don't know. Maybe the mouthpiece fake-out doesn't hit them as hard. It probably hits them a little bit. But for the rest of us who aren't Bud Brisbois and who aren't Bill Chase and Maynard Ferguson, and let's even throw Cat Anderson in there because he's got chops still too. It probably didn't bother him that much either. But for most of us, the new mouthpiece fake-out is real. It does exist, but the key is knowledge. You've heard that before recently on YouTube, haven't you? Remember, it's not for me. It's that guy that goes, "I'm here in my garage. Yeah, these are my two Lamborghinis. You know, it's not really about money, but money is freedom. And you gotta have knowledge.
Here in my garage, just bought this new Lamborghini here. It's fun to drive up here in the Hollywood Hills. But you know what I like a lot more than materialistic things?
And also, I want to let you know that you need to have a mentor. Everybody needs to have a mentor. And you got to have knowledge. It's knowledge. It's knowledge. Now let me go out into my... What's that guy's name? Oh, it just hit me. Ty Lopez. Every time I turn on just to edit one of my YouTube videos, there he is right there. He's in his pool or he's... I'm out in my garage with my two Lamborghinis and... You know, it's not all about money. It's about happiness, wealth, and love, and relationships. That guy's hilarious. Maybe I need to take some lessons from him. Maybe think of that. But actually, it is about knowledge in this new mouthpiece fake out. If you know, it's going to feel great. It's going to feel bad. But then it's going to feel great again. You just hang in there, bide your time. And keep doing what you're doing. I wouldn't take any high-profile gigs that focus on you and the situation where it would be very conspicuous. You know, for example, playing very tough lead stuff, or doing recording sessions and jingles and stuff where you're likely to do a little spiaz and cracks and blips and some intonation things and solving problems because it's new. I wouldn't do that. But just about everything else you probably could. So anyway, I gotta say thanks Bob Reeves for the new mouthpiece. And I guess this is the KT model, so I can got my own little model there. And I'm happy with my new mouthpiece. The same thing happened to me on that one, even though it's a custom, I fell in love with it. I was roughing it for a couple of weeks until I came back out of that inverted bell curve. So now you know the rest of the story when it comes to the new mouthpiece they got. I'm Kurt Thompson, and I think you're going to find this knowledge really, really valuable for your brass playing needs. Bye-bye.
I'm Kurt Thompson at TrumpetSizzle.com and here on YouTube, you're a brass instructor. I'm a professional trumpet player and teacher, and I want to ask you a question. Would you like to learn how to skyrocket your range, improve your endurance, and reduce mouthpiece pressure? At the very least, you should discover that improving range and endurance is a process. It is not one book you're going to read, not one ebook, it's not one lesson you're going to take with a celebrity trumpet player. It is a process that you will have to go through. If you're willing to go through this process, I can almost guarantee that you will get fantastic results on this instrument or any brass instrument. And for right now, I would just like for you to subscribe to my channel. Look down below and click the subscribe link. I would love to have you as a subscriber on my channel, Your Brass Instructor. I'm Kurt Thompson. I'll see you in the next one.
Hey everybody, welcome back to yet another installment at Your Brass Instructor, TrumpetSizzle.com, Kurt Thompson. And as many of you that may or may not know, all you have to do is watch a couple of videos on my channel and you'll know that I'm starting to dibbling and dabbling in the jazz. That's the last frontier for me. Haven't really done much jazz, total jazz-free improvisation in my life. And you might say, Kurt, how could that be possible? Why didn't you do that? Well, let me give you an easy example. I show up on a gig and once people hear me play, I play lead. You know, that's just how it goes. That's what it was when I was younger. After my name got out, all of a sudden they would only have me come in and play lead, or they would only call me if their lead player wasn't there, or I would only take over a lead chair because I could do it. The second thing is, I got very, very good at sight reading. Many of you don't know, but I used to be a session player where I primarily made a good portion of my income going into studios and recording jingles, recording songs and little clips for other people's groups. When I was in Nashville, I got called to go to so many home studios where people were putting together these little different projects and they needed a little trumpet here, a little trumpet there. And then I also did that quite a bit up in Seattle, in Cincinnati, not much in LA, because by that time I was doing a lot more teaching. So what happens to a guy like that that's constantly being called to come in and play and execute? You end up using these more than these. So you have to be an expert sight reader, you have to be an expert player, you have to be on the money. As a result, between those two things, and then also the classical stuff, you know, that I've done before, like when I would do Easter services or Christmas, I primarily focused on those because that's what I did. That's what I got called for. And eventually when I got into doing a lot of Maynard stuff, especially after Maynard passed away, but keep in mind, I started doing Maynard when I was 20. It was my first time that I did Maynard. I started getting pretty good at doing that kind of stuff too. So all that said, I got good at just about every aspect of playing trumpet except for the pure jazz improv. I could show up for some rich person's wedding reception in Seattle, get paid a few hundred dollars to do that, and they would never have me play the second book because they wanted me to do what? They wanted me to play lead. So they wouldn't put me on second book, and the second book player didn't want to play lead all night for 4 hours. Well, you know, you do 45 minutes on, 50 minutes off, you go get a little champagne, a little food there. You know how that goes at the wedding receptions. So yeah, I never really had the opportunity, and no one ever actually kicked me and pushed me and made me do that. So now where I'm at now, I have the luxury of doing what I want, when I want, and how I want it. And so I'm focusing on doing the jazz. I mean, it's for me, it's a challenge. I feel like I'm doing baby steps. I really am. And thank God it's not like lead trumpet and playing in the Maynard Ferguson style. It doesn't require that. Jazz is kind of straightforward to some degree. There's things that you can do to make yourself get better, and it's logical, as opposed to power lead trumpet playing and playing the most hardest of all music that a trumpet player could play, which would be the written high note solo. All that's very counterintuitive and very illogical, and that's why people can be 70 years of age and have a Claude Gordon book and everything else and a James Stamps, and they still have troubles and struggles playing high D's and E's. But the jazz is more straightforward, and I'm kind of getting into it. And I'm doing some of the things that probably you are too, if you're just getting your big toe in the deep end of the cold part of the swimming pool and getting it wet, and you're kind of, you know, dibbling and dabbling like I am. And so I do plan to get better. I do plan to bring myself up to not only a professional level, but one of the best professional jazz trumpet players. It won't be hard to do. I got everything else. All I got to do is just bring in the jazz, and it's all going to be there. But that's easier said than done. So right now I'm doing some different things. And what I discovered is I'm trying to get what I'm hearing in my head out also through my voice, but also to my fingers. And so if I hear, you know, in a fast jazz background with a rhythm section going, and I want to go, well, I hear that in my head, folks, but guess what's not coming out to my fingers? I hear, I hear that in my head. Well, that's in my head, but guess what's not making it to my freaking fingers? And that's where the jazz practice comes in. So I got the ideas, and I'm hearing some cool stuff in my head. And so I get on some of the more pro jazz trumpeter YouTube stuff, and they're also their website. And they're saying, you need to take that look, and you need to walk it through every key. There you go. Walk it through every key and get that down, and then do another lick. Well, I tried doing that. I was like, holy smokes, that's god-awful hard. This is going to take me forever. So then I stumbled on, I was just kind of screwing around. You know, I've done all kinds of different videos, and I like try to put some little cartoon stuff on my videos just because I like it. People know it. Even people, old people know it. Kids know it. And so I thought, well, what if you took a look, like a simple look like Sesame Street? You know Sesame Street, right? Hard as okay. So I thought, okay, what if we start simple? Because I'm not an advanced jazz improv dude. I will be and beyond, but right now I'm just trying to get what's in my head, and I have a whole lot of music theory and a whole lot of this and that in my head. I'm trying to get out to my horn, but I haven't been practicing arpeggios and patterns and all the keys and scales and modes. I'm like a typical second chair player in a jazz band would have been doing, or in a combo situation. So I started thinking, what about a simple little, you know, kids TV show lick like Sesame Street? And so I thought, okay, so you hear it in the key that was played in, which I believe it was in the key of F for trumpet, that'd be E flat. And it might not even be in the key of F. I just pulled that out of my hat. I think that's what it is. But that's not what this is about. So I started thinking, well, wait a minute. To be a good jazzer, don't you have to be able to kind of ramble through that lick in some of the other keys? So I was like, okay, so if I started off on C on that one, well, what if we go up a fourth? Okay, what if you go up another fourth, right? It's called the circle of fourths, right? So how about, what if you go up another fourth? How about another fourth? Now you're trying to, you already know how it sounds like. Bum, 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 bum. You already know that in your head, and now you're taking something pretty simple and getting it out to your fingers, to your horn, because you already know what it's going to sound like. So if we go up the other fourth, well, the other one, no, I already did that one, so now we go continue. Right? Now what if we go to, oh my goodness. And you keep going around the fourth, and what I found, folks, is that it really made me think, and it made me focus more on what was going to happen here at my fingers and the valves. I knew in here what it sounded like, and I knew how to play it on the original key, Starting on C. And when I started going around, I started going, wait a minute. I can see how this is going to help me with my jazz improvisation down the road. And so I've been dibbling and dabbling with the jazz. Of course, I've been going through the different modes, you know, Ionian mode, the Dorian mode, and then the, what do you got? I don't know if it's Phrygian mode, the Lydian mode, the Mixolydian mode, and on and on, Aeolian mode, then Locri mode, then you're back to, you know, I've been going through some of that stuff, and I've been doing the arpeggios, I've been doing some of the scales, and I've been looking at whole tone and half diminished scales and blues scales and pentatonic and all this kind of stuff. So what I found out, it's just big deal if you can, right? I got that down, but when I heard the pattern and the lick come into my head, I couldn't get it out to my fingers exactly. I could do the scale part of it. So when I start taking something simple like Sesame Street and just going around the cycle of fourths, or you could just go up in half steps if you wanted to, you already know what it sounds like. It's just a matter of spitting that out and have your fingers automatically play it on the horn. So as I was going around, I thought, well, that still is a little bit complicated for me, jazz-wise. If I walked into a recording studio and somebody wanted me to play the whole Maynard Ferguson Sesame Street, even though I've heard it but I haven't played it, I could probably go in and sight read it almost perfect. If not, the second take, it's done, send it off. But if you wanted me to improvise with that, that's a whole other kit and caboodle. So I wanted to make this even easier. So I was thinking, let's go to the easiest thing that we could probably think of. And I'm thinking like little baby nursery kind of things, you know, Rockabye Baby, or stuff you, or what, Hot Cross Buns, Mary Had a Little Lamb, just little things like that. And, I thought, well, how difficult would that be? And I found it's actually not easy, folks. Even if you took something like Mary Had a Little Lamb, which in most fifth and sixth grade band books for trumpet, it would actually be in the key of RC, concert B flat, it would start on RE. But something simple like Mary Had a Little Lamb. Da 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 dum bum bum, right? So that's easy, right? But you know it in that key, right? You know. You know that. But what if you didn't know it in our key of F? Right? Going up a fourth. Now you have to start on D, and that would be our key of B flat. So you're taking what you know here and it's translating out to here. Now you started on G. What's going to happen? Right? You go up another fourth, start on C. Okay? Go up another fourth. Now we're on F. Okay? What's the next one, folks, if we go up another fourth? B flat? Ooh, that was actually a hard key and I wasn't even really paying attention. Oh, wait a minute. The real jazzers say there's no such thing as a hard key. Just a key that you're not so familiar with. So, but that particular key, what was that? That was F sharp or G flat? I was actually playing the key of F sharp. If we went up another fourth above that, D sharp, E flat. Okay. How about we'll go up still another fourth. Let's keep going around the circle. G sharp. Okay. Another fourth above that. Oh my goodness, where are we at? I'm getting dizzy. C sharp. Okay, what if we go another fourth above that? Now we're on B natural. Is that right? Yeah, we're on B natural. Are we done yet? I think we're almost done. Yeah, because now we come back to the E. So we made it all the way around through all 12 keys on the, what's called the circle of fourths. And of course, I'm speaking to the advanced player has already done all this stuff. And when I say the circle of fourths, they already know all about that. And they already know why. But I'm actually kind of talking to people who are more at my level, that are just kind of getting into the jazz improv. So the reason that you would do the circle of fourths is because there is a tendency for jazz chords, and a lot of chords in other music too, to move in fourths. There's just a tendency for that to happen. So it doesn't hurt to do what I just did. So I hope that was very educational for you. This is a real jazz improv lesson. And I believe, now, what I just did for someone who's just started into jazz improvisation, what I just demonstrated would be very difficult, I believe, for you. And so I call myself a beginner, but when I say beginner, I'm comparing myself to someone like Arturo, Bobby Shue, Randy Brecker, who else just does nothing but jazz, Winton, John Faddis, James Morrison. I'm putting my level at a beginner compared to them, because I do plan to be definitely at their level at some point in the future. It's not going to be tomorrow, and it's not going to be 5 years from now, but I'm the kind of person that when I put my nose to the grindstone, and when I have an intention, it will happen, because everything else in my life has happened when I've made this intention. But so I'm comparing my level to them, and I call myself a beginner compared to them when it comes to jazz improvisation. Everything else, you know, if they want to, you know, I'll take any of those guys on lead. And actually, I don't think any of those guys want to take me on doing a Maynard Ferguson solo. If they did, they, you know, I'll be glad to, you know, accommodate them. I don't think they want to do that. So, and we all know why. The written high note solo is the most difficult thing that you can do on this instrument, because it has to be played the way it's written out. You don't get a chance to squeedy-dabba-dabba-dabba-dabba when you can't play what's written. You play the written high note solo just like you're supposed to, and it's typically a chart that everybody knows. So you play it like you're supposed to, and if you fuck it up, everybody knows you couldn't play it right. So you can't ease your way out of it with a little bit of finger twist and a little bit of jazz. I mean, that's why the written high note trumpet solo is the most difficult endeavor and difficult music to play on this horn. So, but back to the jazz. Compare all those guys there. I don't feel that they're any better at the stuff I'm good at already right now. But when it comes to the jazz, the pure jazz, yeah, they're freak loads better than me, and I'm just a beginner compared to them when it comes to jazz improvisation. Just a little toddler compared to those guys I just mentioned. Can't do hardly any of the stuff they can do with the jazz improvisation. So, but that's only temporary, folks, because once I set my intention, it's going to happen. And so going back to what I just did, I said that was a beginning kind of thing, but if you actually are a beginner in the jazz, and you might find what I just did to be difficult and somewhat intermediate, or maybe a little bit more on the advanced side, because it's not easy. You think of a melody, and you think of a melody that you maybe that you already know, and you put it through all the keys to the circle of fourths, and it starts to help get what you already know in your hearing transfer it to your hands, to your valves, and My guess is at the very end of this process, whether for me it's going to be 5 years or 10 years or more, or 12 or 15, there will become a time where this will be nothing but a reflex. Nothing but a reflex. I won't be thinking, okay, where am I at? C sharp, A sharp, F sharp, ba-da-da-ba. I won't be thinking that. It'll be a knee-jerk reflex reaction where it will automatically come out when my ears hear the harmony and what we're supposed to be playing. That's down the road, but we got to start somewhere. So anyway, I'm Kurt Thompson. This was, I'm going to actually probably label this a beginning to intermediate jazz improvisation tutorial, because some beginners at jazz improvisation might have found this just a little bit beyond beginner. I don't really consider this an advanced thing that I did today. Certainly, if you ask Wynton Marsalis to do it, John Faddis, Doc Severinsen, they would absolutely laugh because they probably did this decades and decades ago.
Subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Say, so I was just thinking about doing something different in the Clark book today, and I decided to take 98 and transpose it up a half step. I like to make things hard on myself sometimes, so. This is in study 5. 98 is the last one, like that pattern. And I do it all in one breath, which doesn't allow you to stop, start, and reset the curl in and the roll in. That number one makes it already hard enough. So if you do this all and don't take a breath, you're going to really find out if you actually can roll in and roll out in real time in more of a classical thing. Not just a brute force type of exercise or technique like maybe I've demonstrated before in the past. So the other thing is, this is for the classical guys. You jazz guys, a lot of times you don't really transpose that much. I mean, you get in the jazz jam and what do you got to do? You got to transpose usually up a whole step because the rhythm section is going to do a blues in D, right? Well, that means for us trumpet players, that's, holy crap, E. Or what if they do something in E, which is very easy for rhythm section because one of the strings on the guitar and bass is E. So that means F sharp for us, F sharp blues. So for 98, to make things a little bit more difficult and to maybe lure in some of the classical guys that are used to transposition. And by the way, here's just a quick tip. I went through and mastered the entire Caffarelli book years ago when I was undergrad. And anybody that knows anything about the Caffarelli book, it will turn you into a pretty decent player that can transpose in all different kinds of keys. Anybody that can go through and master the Caffarelli book with about a 95% accuracy would get a two thumbs up and two toes up for me, because that's a kind of a bitchin' book. I mean, it really makes you think to transpose like that. So anyway, back to the study in the Herbert L. Clark. Fifth study, and anyway, 98, I was just fooling around with it. Now I could do 98 upside down blindfolded. It has one flat in the key, and I thought, let's make it harder. How much harder would it be just to simply single tongue it at not too fast of a clip? Just even single tongue, just like a robot,
I'm not even paying attention to the dynamics really so much. And I found it very difficult for me to be very accurate, tonguing, plus transposing up into trumpet F sharp major, and using the real-time roll-in, roll-out, all in one breath. The final take you're going to hear me do came after a good 3 or 4 attempts, and it still isn't perfect. Now contrast that, I end this particular tutorial still transposing up a half step into trumpet F sharp major, but I slur everything. One take. The take that you're going to hear is my one and only take I did slurred. You have to agree, it sounds so much smoother, so much easier. And the reason is that I've been able to figure out is that the tongue disallows 100% constant compressed stream of air. Every time you tongue, your tongue arch drops to some degree. And so even if you maintain a tongue arch when you go higher, it still drops to some degree. But when you have this type of study where you're going low and high and low and high, you're constantly going back and forth from an uncompressed position to a compressed position with your tongue arch, making this study to be very, very difficult. Then transpose it up into 6 sharps. And so what you're actually looking at when you play, you're not even looking at the real notes that are coming out the horn. The notes coming out the horn are coming out a half step higher. All this requires a supreme amount of intelligence, talent, and practice under your belt. It's not magic, but you have to have all those qualities. I mean, you're doing a tremendous amount of thinking, and it'd be kind of cool if someone else would do this. Oh, the other thing is, classical guys, did you notice? By the way, yeah, can you see me? Yeah, it's me, Kurt Thompson here. The light's kind of doing a little this and that. Oh, I did all that on my big B-flat. So you classical guys, you know, you can't get out your B-flat A pick. You can't get out your E-flat small horn, as I call it. No. In fact, I don't even want you to do it on the C horn, which is smaller than the B-flat. I want you to, that doesn't count if you do it on a C horn. I want you to get out the big horn. Yeah. I want you to get out your big B-flat. And you do everything like I just did on the big B flat. The piccolos and E flat trumpet, no. C trumpet, not really. I mean, you're still cheating a little bit on this one. Get out the big B flat. Don't be scared of it. And you're going to find out real quickly what you're made of. And you're going to find out real quickly how accurate you are in the upper register. You're going to find out very, very quickly that PhD and DMA you have after your name that you worked so hard to get doesn't mean too much right now. You know, putting your feet to the fire. This is a test. So if you just got your DMA and you're thinking that you're hot shit and you're looking around for that professorship somewhere, you need to make sure you can play your horn, because most can't. Why don't you set the tone for a guy that has all that academic suffixes after your name and be able to play your freaking horn and not regurgitate the same bullshit that you learned when you got your DMA. Can't see my face, but you can hear my mouth run, and that's the most important thing. So, that's 98 transposed up a half step, easy for me to say, in the fifth study of the Clark. Set your metronome so you don't speed up and slow down. It doesn't have to be fast. It just needs to be even, like you heard me do it. And work the tonguing first. And then notice how much easier it is when you go to slurring. It just, wow, it's just like a cakewalk. After you do the tonguing, like I said, I did this for three, four, five times, and I finally took the best take. This was live. And then I went to the tonguing, and that take you hear on the tonguing is my first, I'm sorry, the slurring. And the slurred one is the first take, first and only take. came out like smooth butter, just dripping on a, you know, hot ear of corn. So this is a very important one. I don't want to say I just stumbled on it, but I just got a wild hair up my left toe, you know what I mean? And I thought, what the hell? Let's transpose this baby up a half step. We're going to make it hard, and we're going to tongue it. And of course, if you haven't figured out, I end up hitting, that's the double F sharp, folks, that I hit at the end of this. The double F sharp. Double F sharp. Double high F sharp. That's the note that I hit at the end of this one. Try it yourself. And if you can actually do this, I would love to promote you on my channel as a guy that, or a gal, that took the initiative, went and tried to do this, and actually made a video of yourself, put yourself out there. I promise you, if you did a decent, now if you clam bake this thing all over the place, I'm not going to put it up on my channel and embarrass you. But if you make the effort to make a video of yourself doing this, and you got to have yourself in the camera. I don't want any black screens, because then we don't know if you went over to, you know, Maurice Andre's grave and he played it for you. You got to have yourself in the picture so we know who it is, and you got to use your real name. You want to get a little fame, and you want an instant 5,000 people to be able to watch your stuff, then go ahead and go for it. Make the effort. This needs to be transposed into F sharp major. You need to tongue it and slur it. If you got the you know what to do it, record it, send it to me, and I'll make sure a ton of brass players watch you play it. Over and out. You know, I've been kind of messing around doing the palming Dr. Charles Colin lip slurs and lip trills, and I've been finding it quite tough. I mean, you can't use any mouthpiece pressure. So I'll just give you an example. You know, you do the horn here, you know, it's palmed. And so you make your hand. Now, French horn players, you'll probably have to do this. Trombone players, maybe also. Baritone players, I'm not exactly sure how you would do that unless you could put your, like, you know how a tuba will put their tuba in a big tuba stand. And if you put the tuba in the stand and you just went up to it with the mouthpiece like that, that would be almost the equivalent. So if you could put your euphonium or baritone in some kind of a stand, then you could probably get the technique we're after here. So you make your hand like a shelf, and I would just kind of mess around doing some lip trill, just seeing where I was at. As you've heard in other past tutorials, I've been able to, you know, lip trill pretty decently up to triple G's, but that was using a tremendous amount of mouthpiece pressure at the very end, so that was pretty tough for me. But here I am. I'm gonna just do it this way so you can see. That's C to E easy. Obviously that's E to G. G to B flat. B flat to C. Okay, so that was B flat to high C. Now, also I'm doing these rather loud. I would say that was just pushing probably forte. You're not going to get too much out of your lip trills in the Charles Colin book if you're playing them pianissimo or piano. I recommend all my students that were at least at the MF mark. MF to F is good. Probably fortissimo is not good. You're going to be blowing so loud, you're going to be defeating the purpose of the technique. So keep these around MF to F. So that was a B flat to high C. So palming. Now look how I got it. I don't know if you can see. I'm only using the weight of the horn, and I'm not doing this. I'm not grabbing and pulling. There we go. Let's try to go a little higher. That was C to D. D to E. Now this will probably come out flat. And then, geez, I don't even know if I can make this last one. I can't get the G to lock in, but I will get it. So I was going for the trill from F to double G. I think it kind of came out. It got a little bit weak. Let's see if I can get it again. Barely. So I ended up on a double G. Now, folks, I'm probably making that look too easy, so I want you to try it. And why would I say I'm making it look too easy? Well, one of the techniques in my course does kind of focus on the Roy Stevens, William Costello, no pressure system palming. Now, we're not doing it exactly as Roy would have had his students do, because I'm not doing the whole gap in the teeth thing and the forward jaw and the upstream type of embouchure that is the Stevens embouchure. So we're not really doing that, but we're actually doing the physical exercise to kind of strengthen up our chops. So the reason I mentioned that might have looked too easy is because when people come into my course, a lot of people have trouble just doing this. Just going to the E. Now that's just a slur going up. I would say more than half the people getting in my course cannot do what I just did there. That was simply going up to a high G. Low C, G, C, E, G. And to go up the next one, now we're going to whittle out almost all people that start my course. That's the B flat. I might, if I had 10 people start my course over the last quarter, maybe two would be able to do what I just did there. And then finally, I don't know, if I had 10 people start my course over the live course now, the one that they're seeing me every week live, either via Skype or on the phone, maybe one would be able to do what I just did right there. And that's just a maybe. So take this technique to heart in this drill, and it's a good challenge. I mean, we're all brass players, and it seems like brass players, and especially trumpet players, like a good challenge in the competition and to challenge ourselves. And wow, can you think of a better challenge than this? Yeah, because I mean, come on. If I got on normally, I mean, what the hell? I just did that lip trill from double C to double D. And if I warm it up a little bit more, I know it can go another 3 or 4 steps higher. Because I'm playing normally and got the right pressure that I want. So this shows you, you saw that I kind of thinned out going up to that double G, lip trilling it. So if I can go an octave higher playing normally, you know there's something to this technique. And I highly recommend that you start playing around and challenging yourself. Think outside the box, use your brain. You have to constantly keep moving upwards and expanding everything and advancing your horn. It doesn't stop. It hasn't stopped with me. I'm still looking at areas. Right now I'm looking at the jazz area. Although I feel like for a guy that's, done it for, I'm not even really seriously doing it, but I am looking at it. I am doing some different things with the jazz and jazz improvisation. And I feel like the little effort and input that I've done has actually got me, a couple of spots upwards. So now, do I really have to do all the jazz? No, because I have classical skills and commercial skills that tend to put me ahead of the pack and make me stand out. But I'm not satisfied with that, because I want to keep expanding, keep improving. And so I'm looking at the jazz as kind of a last frontier for me. And I've been noticing when I've just been kind of fooling around playing with some of the legends of jazz, the living legends, it's at the point now where I feel like I'm kind of hanging in there with them. I mean, just on some of the recordings, and I'm like, wait a minute, I'm able to hang in there with these guys.
And jazz is definitely not my forte now. Who knows? Maybe down the road it will be. So the whole idea is you keep trying different things and experimenting and adding different things to your regimen to keep improving. What is the opposite of that? The opposite of that would be to, for 30 years, pull out your Claude Gordon book and be doing this. On and on and up. I mean, if you're doing that for 30 years and you're doing nothing else, I can guarantee you just aren't that far along, my friend. Be smart.
I'm Kurt Thompson at TrumpetSizzle.com and here on YouTube, you're a brass instructor. I'm a professional trumpet player and teacher, and I want to ask you a question. Would you like to learn how to skyrocket your range, improve your endurance, and reduce mouthpiece pressure? At the very least, you should discover that improving range and endurance is a process. It is not one book you're going to read, not one ebook, it's not one lesson you're going to take with a celebrity trumpet player. It is a process that you will have to go through. If you're willing to go through this process, I can almost guarantee that you will get fantastic results on this instrument or any brass instrument. And for right now, I would just like for you to subscribe to my channel. Look down below and click the subscribe link. I would love to have you as a subscriber on my channel, Your Brass Instructor. I'm Kurt Thompson. I'll see you in the next one.
Okay, you're thinking you're doing pretty good, but in the pit of your stomach, you're kind of wondering if you're using way too much mouthpiece pressure. If you're wondering that, you probably are. But let's just face it, in case you didn't know it, we all use the maximum amount of mouthpiece pressure at the very last note that we can play in our top range. And that goes for everybody, anywhere, anytime, any place. And the way you could prove that, you know, like if I wanted to go up to Mr. Arturo Sandoval and shake his hand and say, lovely playing, and it's just amazing what you're able to do in the upper register, you know, wow, could I hear your triple G, your triple G? And if he goes and plays it, like, that's great. Can I hear the A? He'll play the A. Can I hear the triple C? Play triple C. If I keep asking Arturo Sandoval to keep playing the next note, at some point, a note will not come out. And the reason that note will not come out is because Arturo would have exceeded the maximum amount of mouthpiece pressure. And at some point, he'll press so hard that the lips will no longer vibrate. Even the little small aperture right here will no longer vibrate because he will have exceeded the maximum amount of mouthpiece pressure for himself. So that's just the way it is for everybody. We all have a max range. Of course, we can increase that, but wherever you are right now, when you can't go any higher, you're actually at your maximum mouthpiece pressure because you've actually stopped up the lips.
Thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Okay, so if you want to increase your power and your dynamic level in the fortissimo direction, you might want to kind of follow my path here, kind of follow my role, and that is a couple times a week. Now, you can't do it more than a couple times a week because it will start to screw up your intuition. It'll start to screw up your intonation and your ability to center notes. If you practice on a mute all the time, I've already learned that lesson when I lived in San Francisco, it will screw you up a little bit. But now if you take a good harmon mute and you allow yourself a half an hour to 45 minutes twice a week and just blow your freaking brains. Do you realize how loud I was just playing there, folks? I mean, I'm in an apartment. I mean, if I didn't have that mute, I'm here to tell you, man, it wouldn't be long before I'd hear sirens. I mean, it was that loud. I mean, really. So my shirt looks kind of funny here. Or maybe it's because I got the little black thing going on. I actually have two arms. It looks it kind of looked like my arm was cut off or something in this picture. But no, I still have my other arm there, so don't worry about that. But seriously, folks, man, I can't tell you how loud I was playing. I mean, it had to be in the 4F range. It would be plenty loud. I would cut through any Blue Devil's horn line. I will freaking tell you that. You know, give me the Blue Devils and give me the best sopranos from years past. I'll tell you what I was just playing right there. That double A would cut through them. And you'd hear me bury that fucking horn line to the Blue Devil. I'm not joking about this. But the thing about it is, the having the mute in there, it kind of empowers you because you can blow and you're not going to hurt your ears and you don't have to worry headphones and earplugs and you don't have to worry about, you know, anybody in your house or apartment getting upset by it. So if you, I mean, you need to add all the stuff up that I'm telling you, folks. If you do it, man, you're just going to turn into a pretty awesome trumpet player, at least on the physical side. I mean, so you get the harmon, you got to get a good one too. Don't get one of the little crappy plastic stone lined ones. It's got to be a great harmon mute. You know, mine is that's all copper, and I think years ago it cost me about $175. Maybe it came down in price, I don't know. But that's it's a pretty decent harmon mute. It's heavy too. So my advice for you, if you want to increase your power, you need to blow against resistance from time to time. Resistance, think of resistance as resistance weight training. If you want to increase your power for pushing and pulling, then you use resistance, a resistance as in like a pull down machine or dumbbell curls, right? Or dips. And that will increase your power that way. Well, here's what we're using, the harmon mute, because the harmon mute creates resistance. Why? Because we have to blow hard. It makes it not so easy to blow right through the bell of the horn. So the harmon mute isn't, what's the best way to say it? Impediment. There we go, an impediment to the air. So you have to blow against that obstruction, the bell of your horn, called a harmon mute. And when you have to blow against it, you're working muscles and you're working your chops in such a way that you're going to be able to build power. This is just one way to build power. There are several others that are in my 16-week upper register course. Thought I would give that a plug. And you can't just build power with one technique. So this technique won't be a miracle pill for you, but it all adds up. So you need to go back and rewind this and check out how loud I was playing. You won't be able to tell, I don't think, through your speakers, but I'm here to tell you, man, I was burning it up. I mean, it's just good that my the music that I was reading off was not flammable, because that music would have started on fire, baby.
Thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Here's a close-up of my chops. You probably should be able to see the lip roll in the aperture. I'm buzzing right in the sun. Bum,
I don't even know what note I'm buzzing. Sounds like a high C. So watch closely. Yeah, let's see if you can actually see it. Under the shadows getting in there. Yeah, right there. Anyway, that's a close-up, maybe closer than you wanted, but I'm right in the sun, so I'll have to go back later and edit this and actually see if things are a little bit more clear. They gotta be more clear because I'm right in the sun. You can actually see what part of my mouth I'm buzzing out of. It's pretty much center. And anyway, hope you enjoyed that close-up shot of my chops.
Thanks again for watching this video. I hope that you got something out of it. Sometimes I make a video just to make you laugh. A lot of times I make a video to educate you on something and maybe even help solve a problem. So I hope something like that occurred for you in this video. And while you're at it, again, subscribe, click on my website link, and go on to the next video. It's lovely out here. Have a great day.
Barely got the triple C on this. So the mouthpiece. Should you be doing some mouthpiece buzzing every day? Of course you should. In many ways, the mouthpiece is definitely harder than play the horn. And go further, lip buzzing by itself is harder than mouthpiece buzzing and the horn. So the mouthpiece is kind of halfway in between. Problem for most people is they don't know exactly what to do on this, and if they were a classical player, more than likely they're doing way too much mouthpiece buzzing, and that has a tendency to thin out the lips, reduce your endurance, reduce the cushion in your lips, and actually reduce your range. So I know a lot of classical players that we'll say that they buzz their mouthpiece a half an hour before they even touch their horn, or they buzz their mouthpiece an hour before they even touch their horn. That's going to keep you right in the classical arena permanently. I mean, you're not going to ever be able to do jazz or rock or lead or do recording sessions or be that A-list player because it's going to keep your range down. A lot of times it thins out your sound, so you don't have this big brassy sound. But yet, so where's the fine line in mouthpiece buzzing? There is a fine line. So you can use this as a useful tool. It also is a little bit of an ear trainer. Enhances your flexibility. And if done properly, you can start to use it to bump up your range just a little bit. Like lip buzzing, I wouldn't really call this a poison. Lip buzzing can definitely be a poison if you do way too much of it. I mean, it can just totally kill you off. Mouthpiece buzzing, to some extent, yes, it's not near as potent as the lip buzzing. But the sweet spot is where and how much and what do you need to be doing on the mouthpiece? Well, I'm just going to give you a few tips here. I've already given you one. Number one, don't be that person that is mouthpiece buzzing a half an hour to an hour a day before you practice. That's a no-brainer. You're going to end up being a more anemic, weaker player. Maybe your ear training might be better.
but everything else is going to be worse. So don't be that guy or gal that buzzes on this thing for an hour before you do anything. You're going to be worse range and power wise. Like, that I'll guarantee you. The second thing is, a couple things you might want to consider in the mouthpiece buzzing would be scales, arpeggios, and then being able to pick out some certain notes. And I think you already heard me did that. But just a simple one I think that's doable for a lot of people is just to do the C major scale. Concert B flat. Surprisingly enough, a lot of people that come through my course, not everyone, but a lot of them do have trouble just doing something like that. The scale up, the arpeggio up, hitting the target notes. So my advice to you, if you don't do any mouthpiece buzzing, start doing a little bit every day, maybe a couple of minutes. Try doing a couple of scales. Try doing some arpeggios and maybe just picking out some notes, you know, in the upper register. If you're already doing mouthpiece buzzing and you're one of those persons that wakes up and does this for a half an hour to an hour, I'm telling you, if you want to play something else besides brass quintet or a third cornet part in your concert band, you're just going to have to stop that. You really are. You got to tone the mouthpiece buzzing all the way down. Use this as a tool to build and not as your meat and potatoes. This is the guy that you need to be playing. If you're going to be playing for half an hour, an hour, you play this guy. This one here, you know, maybe up to 5 minutes, maybe 10, maybe 10 minutes. You're kind of pushing it. But somewhere right around there is a sweet spot. My bet is if you haven't done the mouthpiece and you start doing a little bit, you will notice something positive happen in your playing. Could be that your notes lock a little bit better, they slot better. Could be your flexibility is a little bit better. And on the flip side of the coin, if you've been doing too much of this, you back off down to 5 or 10 minutes a day and start doing some of the stuff I just talked about, you too might start to notice, wait a minute, my range is going up, my power is coming back, my tone's coming back. So there are some benefits. It just depends on what side of the fence you are on when it comes to mouthpiece buzzing. This is for all brass instruments, by the way. So anyway, I'm Kurt Thompson. I hope you found this helpful. I guess one thing it just occurred to me is when it comes to mouthpiece buzzing, you can't really use a significant amount of pressure. I mean, you can, but not like the horn. I mean, even when I was doing the, see, we got a C there, should be, got pretty close. Well, that's a double C. Now, I really couldn't use too much pressure to get that double C to come out. You just the way you grab the mouthpiece and everything, you just can't. It was hard to explain, but you can demonstrate to yourself, put it in the horn, then try playing it and use the mouthpiece, and you'll find you just can't pull in, you can't really exceed the mouthpiece pressure as much as you might on the horn. So that's kind of another good thing about this guy. You're not going to really kill yourself on him. Anyway, try doing some mouthpiece buzzing. And if you've been doing it way too much, try cutting back. And I'm pretty confident you're going to start to notice some improvements in your playing. See you next time. Well, I'm just going to give you a few tips here. I've already given you one. Number one, don't be that person that is mouthpiece buzzing a half an hour to an hour a day before you practice. That's a no-brainer. You're going to end up being a more anemic, weaker player. Maybe your ear training might be better, but everything else is going to be worse. So don't be that guy or gal that buzzes on this thing for an hour before you do anything. You're going to be worse range and power wise. Like, that I'll guarantee you. The second thing is, a couple things you might want to consider in the mouthpiece buzzing would be scales, arpeggios, and then being able to pick out some certain notes. And I think you already heard me did that. But just a simple one I think that's doable for a lot of people is just to do the C major scale. Concert B flat. surprisingly enough, a lot of people that come through my course, not everyone, but a lot of them do have trouble just doing something like that. The scale up, the arpeggio up, hitting the target notes. So my advice to you, if you don't do any mouthpiece buzzing, start doing a little bit every day, maybe a couple of minutes. Try doing a couple of scales. Try doing some arpeggios and maybe just picking out some notes, you know, in the upper register. If you're already doing mouthpiece buzzing and you're one of those persons that wakes up and does this for a half an hour to an hour, I'm telling you, if you want to play something else besides brass quintet or a third cornet part in your concert band, you're just going to have to stop that. You really are. You got to tone the mouthpiece buzzing all the way down. Use this as a tool to build and not as your meat and potatoes.
I'm Kurt Thompson at TrumpetSizzle.com and here on YouTube, you're a brass instructor. I'm a professional trumpet player and teacher, and I want to ask you a question. Would you like to learn how to skyrocket your range, improve your endurance, and reduce mouthpiece pressure? At the very least, you should discover that improving range and endurance is a process. It is not one book you're going to read, not one ebook. It's not one lesson you're going to take with a celebrity trumpet player. It is a process that you will have to go through. If you're willing to go through this process, I can almost guarantee that you will get fantastic results on this instrument or any brass instrument. And for right now, I would just like for you to subscribe to my channel. Look down below and click the subscribe link. I would love to have you as a subscriber on my channel, Your Brass Instructor. I'm Kurt Thompson. I'll see you in the next one.